So after getting a few servos installed on the railroad, it occurs to me to start thinking about how am I going to control them all, because they're spread all over the place. So do I want to put an Arduino in each general area? Do I want to put one centralized and fan it out? Because one Arduino can handle between 12 and 16 servos, I think, or a lot more if I use a mega, an 18 mega, a mega, one of those. Because it's got a ridiculous amount of pins. So that's a possibility. And then I can put all the detection on there and all the turnouts on there. But maybe I don't want that. Maybe I want something like a nano or something like that. So I got this breakout board that has all these pins set up on here in the right configuration for servos. And I thought that's cool. So I'll make sure I get these the right way up, otherwise bad things happen. And get them on the ones that I've programmed on there. So was the other one? 12, I think I put it on. So I could do that. And then powered off the barrel jack, or in this case I've just got my little power supply over here. Why is that so curled up and horrible? Black is ground. White is positive. And then I can control multiple servos like that. And it's all convenient. But I'm going to have to crimp pins onto the cables coming from the detection. That's not a bad thing. That's possible. So then there's this breakout board plus the nano, two or three of those around the railroad. That's not a bad plan. I could also use these breakout boards with those screw terminals on them. And if I do that, then I can just run extension wires to where the servos and stuff are, rather than it just having to be, you know, within that length. Or I suppose I can take some crimp pins and make extensions for those. So that's another option. Or I could... So then, anyways, yeah. Can you tell I'm working without a script? I'm just kind of figuring this out as I go. So then with this, it occurred to me, I wonder how far I can put a servo away from the nano. So I got another one of those baseboards, hooked up just some Cat 5 because I had it lying around. Get in. Pause. Okay, well, that was a little bit messy. Sorry about that. So, anyway, so I got a chunk of Cat 5 here. Long enough to go out the door around the furnace and back in the room if I had to. For now, I'm just running three conductors across it. These three here, voltage, ground, and the control signal, and just taking them off the screw terminals. So I'm gonna hook that guy up. It works. It's not jumping quite as quickly as they did over there on this board, presumably because there's 50 or 60 feet of 22 gauge wire in series with it. So that may not be the best option. However, nothing says I have to run the power that distance. I could just run the control signal. Actually, can I do this quickly? I don't know, maybe. No, because it's still moving around. No, I'm gonna pause and I'll come back again here. Okay, so now I've got the power and ground coming from my little 5-volt power supply here, through the Wago connectors, through a much shorter and a little bit thicker wire. This one, the ground one, I have the ground coming from the Arduino, the ground coming from the power supply, and the ground pin going to the servo, all connected to each other. So, turn the power supply on, power the Arduino separately, and I think you can tell that that guy's bouncing a lot sharper, a lot more positively than it was before. So, that's definitely better. So, I can run the signal line, which is the blue wire here, through that huge length of Cat 5. So that's a possibility too. Especially for places where I've got just one turnout out in the boonies somewhere, and I don't need to have an Arduino coaster there. In a yard or a place with a high concentration of turnouts, yeah, it makes sense to do maybe this. Or even this, one of these scooter mall shields. But I think that makes more sense for that kind of an application. However, the other thing that I found is this Pro Mini, which has all the pins already on it, significantly smaller, cheaper than buying a Nano Plus, plus a baseboard. Baseboards are buck or two, Nanos are, what are they these days? $3 Canadian, $3.50, something like that. This one was, damn it, what was it? I'll have to go and check. I'm sure I'll edit it up on the screen. But it's less expensive than a Nano Plus. Although this Nano is one of the cheap ones. It's not a 328. It's a 168, which are only a couple of dollars rather than $3. And for this, I don't need the speed. I don't need the processing power. This is just a dead simple application. But hooking this thing up operates pretty much the same as that guy, which I'll demonstrate here. Okay, so here is set up with just that little Pro Mini board. And while I had the camera paused, that one cost me $4.90 Canadian. Whereas a Nano, just a regular old Nano, costs about $3.50 Canadian. And this breakout board, or what is it called? An I.O. shield, or sensor shield, I guess, cost just under $2. So it's comparable. Obviously takes up less space, but it definitely does the job. And I mean, it's not actually that much smaller than, or not that much bigger than a regular Pro Mini, which is what that guy is back there. Yeah, those guys can do whatever. So there's one more option that I looked at, and I'll have to bring that in a second here. Okay, back again. That took longer than I expected. So here is this board that I showed you briefly before. It basically takes I2C in there, separate 5 volts. I mean, there's 5 volts coming down there, but that's just for the logic. Separate 5 volts here, which is obviously going to be a beefier power supply because that is driving the voltage out to the servos. So this can be as long as an I2C cable can be, which I've seen various different things from as short as possible to up to 10 meters with appropriate cable. So that's a possibility. I can run a heavy gauge power bus to these and just put them where they need to be. Then the Arduino can be centralized. And apparently you can daisy chain them as well. There is I squared C output there, and and so you can theoretically just daisy chain them on and on. You just have to change the address, which I think you can see it there. There's some jumper pads that you can short out to change the address on them. The library, courtesy of our good friends at Adafruit, says that it can handle, I think, however many addresses there are there. Quickly, but up to like 64 of these modules times 16 servos, which is a ridiculous number and way more than I'm gonna need. But it works. I'm just using the demo sketch that came with the library. I didn't bother to code my own thing in there. So there's the power for the Arduino. It's running right now, and there's the logic power on this guy. Now I turn on the power to this, which is actually driving that, and what the hell, nothing's happening. Arduino reset. There we go. So there we go. And as you can hear, they sound like they got some good jam to them too. Which makes sense because the power leads are short and not too lightweight. So there's the other possibility. I'm probably, at the end of the day, going to use a combination of these ideas. I like this little guy. I might actually use this one for the sensing inputs. And use some combination of these three here for driving the servos. Which means then I need to get the one that's monitoring all the inputs to talk via I squared C, presumably, to the ones that are driving the servos. And that shouldn't be too hard because that's all going to be in software. Well, okay. That shouldn't be too hard for somebody who understands software. For me, I might have to employ my 16-year-old to actually do the software for me to make it work. But there's the plan. Hope this was vaguely informative, or at least not completely boring. Bye.